seeing at Gartner are some maybe some best practices, some thought leadership in those areas while we're waiting for people to pull in?
Yeah, some of the best practices we're seeing literally revolve around going back to basics and thinking about exactly how do I, as an individual employee or as a customer visiting my site, for example, or as a partner visiting my site, I'm going to actually experience the office or the location all the way from the ground up. And so the one best practice is to literally start by saying, you know, someone gets up in the before someone's scheduled to come back into the office. Some period of time before that, do they have to do anything in order to be able to get into the office? Many organizations are now requiring people to pre-register with what's going on. So that's that whole pre-visit aspect of it. Then they think about what's the actual physical contact of walking into the office. Is my building, is the company that's managing my building going to take people's temperatures? Or do I have to take people's temperatures when they get to my location? How do I handle even things as mundane as elevators and moving people around, et cetera? When they get there, what's the environment going to be like? The physical environment, the spacing, the use of plexiglass, and then how do all those technologies fit together? Because I now have to now maintain a contact with my office environment. My office, being whether it's virtual or real, now has to be able to work across all of these different modes, from in a home office, for example, where I have a Wi-Fi line, or you know, I'm in transit. On mobile Wi-Fi or something else, and then I'm actually in the office. And how do I make that as seamless as possible? How do I control the access to documentation and security of the documents and materials that are flowing around? And all of those things become very, very important as you think through that. And that's really the best practice. And at each stage of those environments, the question is what is my employee or my customer or my partner or my supplier touching? What do they see? How do they feel? How do we want them to feel? What can they do? What can't they do? How do I tell them what they can't, you know, the things that they can't do that they used to be able to do and the rationale for them? And I think that whole immersive environment becomes absolutely critical. And in dealing with that whole immersive environment, there's whole rafts of things that you can actually then move around and say, well, I can assume that the technology is always going to be provided because we're going to manage the technology this way. I'm going to assume that the policies are going to be handled because HR is defining new policies here. And I think that that notion of a holistic approach that's then not divided, but coordinated across all of these different domains is very important.
Great, thanks. I think, and maybe Jared will touch on this from a technological standpoint, some of the best practices as well. You know, what are we seeing around security? What are the collaboration tools? Mark, you may be able to touch on that a little bit as well. So I think we're interested in hearing some of the technological best practices.
Sure.
As well as the social and cultural best practices. Let's put the polling slide up. Hopefully people have had a chance to text CompuCom C207. And now what you can see here is send your answer to this question to number 22333. Gartner studies show that X percent of companies plan to permanently shift to remote work post COVID. You can see the numbers coming in. And it seems like 74% seems to be a favorite right now. Although D is making its way. And okay, I think looks like we're about 60-30 between C and D. For your information, the answer is C, 74%. So 74% of companies plan to permanently shift to more remote work post-COVID, which is amazing. I gotta believe now the hybrid environment that we're working in, where before maybe 20% of our employees had remote capabilities. So you had an infrastructure that supported 80% in the office and 20% remote. Now it's gonna be significantly different. And this is Gartner. Curious, have any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I think it is significantly going to be significantly different, and the that just places increased demand on IT professionals and other professionals to provide the tools and the technologies to enable people to be effective in all of these different settings. because one of the other changes has been is like with the collaboration tools, like, you know, that are available from Microsoft or other people, or even the WebEx that we're on right now, the notion is no longer if you're out of the office, you're unreachable. The expectations increasingly, if you're out of the office, you are at least as productive as if you were in the office. And that requires a whole slew of technologies to make that happen.
Yeah, great. All right, so let me jump to the next question and then we'll turn it over to Jared. Question two, pre-COVID, Gartner research showed that 30% of workers worldwide at least a partial entitlement to work at home. Post COVID-19, they believe the number grow to X number of employees globally. You see A, B, C, and D there. All right, looks like D is becoming the winner, and the answer actually is C, 48%. So 48% of employees will be at least partially entitled to work at home. Think about it, let's just round it up to 50%. Half of our employees will be remote post-COVID. Staggering numbers compared to what it was pre-COVID. Almost a factor of 2x. So again, collaboration, technologically, how are we prepared to handle both of those environments, and then socially. So Jared, we're interested in hearing Intel's perspective, and then we're going to open it up for some Q&A for the audience.
Yeah, definitely, Mike. And interesting data point that's validated in regards to the data that you've seen from the texting and everything. But there was one survey that I picked up on this morning that hit our distribution. So it was Fortune 500 CEO survey. And the question was, when will, 80% of your workforce get back on site? And almost 27% of them said never. That they're never going to hit that threshold of those employees coming back on site. So, from the input that you're seeing from your survey and everything, how we work, how we engage, everything is changing moving forward. And as Mark said, we need to adapt. We need to adapt as workers. We need to adapt as executives, and we need to adapt as technologists and IT shops moving forward. So, can we go to the next slide? We'll go ahead and kick off for this. And Mark hit upon this, and I think across the board, just to kind of make a additional points, I won't belabor everything that Mark hit upon in regards to this, but across the board, organizations are really trying to figure this out. I would say across our engagements and working with executives and organizations with multiple industries across the board, the key theme is continuity. It's business continuity. It's healthcare continuity. When you look at the healthcare continuity piece, so I sit on a board of directors, board of trustees for a large health system and on the Gulf Coast. And some of the things that we're trying to adjust, for getting through kind of, the flattening out of the COVID curve, but also what is healthcare going to look like moving forward and how do we address that? And the last piece is, education continuity is a big thing. And I think that everyone has been impacted by this, that, has kids have come home. How do you have that virtual learning environment? What is it going to look like, as we try to get back to school in the fall in some sort of, learning environment, if it's all face-to-face, if it's all virtual or kind of a mixed bag, but across the board. But, what we're seeing is that organizations are really embracing this continuity piece. How do they really get their arms around, because the consensus feel from what we are seeing is that over the foreseeable future going in through, let's say through the second half this year until we get across probably into the first part of next year, the whole COVID impact with hotspots and, ramping up a positive test, it's going to oscillate up and down across the board. So organizations are going to have to be able to be very nimble, very agile to really embrace that continuity mindset, to do all the things that Mark had talked about, that workplace of the future and how that's going to evolve. you know, some of the things that we're seeing is, you know, it is waves of change and innovation and adaptation. And what we saw was a big spike, you know, of, you know, technology engagement, technology purchase, you know, let's say in the, you know, the March, April timeframe. And now what we're seeing is organizations really step back and try to figure out, how do we digest this out? How do we put it in an activation strategy? How do we make sure that we have that right infrastructure and that virtual infrastructure of all the key components that Mark had talked about, and really putting that in place, which is, you know, which is key thing. So again, you know, we're leaning in, and can we go to the next slide, please, in regards to this? And, you know, where, you know, where Intel is making changes, you know, and what we're trying to do across the board is, you know, working with, you know, our end user accounts, we're working with, you know, partners like CompuCom, you know, what do we need to put in place, and what are the solution areas that we need to invest in to help accelerate so that organizations can address continuity, can have that in place, can move it forward? How can they really activate that, you know, future of virtual work moving forward, all the components that Mark had talked about? And I was taking notes during Mark's presentation. It's, you know, the who, the where, the how, the skills, and those types of things. You know, what are the underlying technology components and pillars that need to be put in place? And I can tell you from an Intel perspective, we have pivoted our resources to dedicate towards this so that we can enable, you know, our end user customers, our partners, so that they can address this. You know, some of the things that, you know, we are seeing: virtual everything across the board, you know, the end-to-end, you know, VDI solution, how is that going to play out? I hit upon the remote learning and working, what is it going to look like moving forward? And then also, I think, you know, when you look at the digital businesses, you know, what I've seen is that we were going through transformation over the past 24 and 36 months of this digital transformation. What I feel is COVID-19 and, you know, this impact has really accelerated that. And you see organizations in three different buckets: being they're surviving, they're adapting, or they're growing in the new environment. So how are IT organizations are really going to partner, you know, within the organization, either from to solve opportunities, to address challenges, but to really accelerate that new digital transformation moving forward. And then also on the last piece, I think, you know, the network modernization piece, which some things I am super excited about is, you know, the promise and the evolution of 5G and how it's really going to accelerate some of these use cases in digital transformation. So these are the areas that we are working through. We're investing across the board. Hey, we know, you know, edge to cloud, cybersecurity are a key component of it, but you'll look in, you'll see more from Intel, you know, as we work with our customers and our partners moving forward. We go ahead to the next slide. High level overview, you know, what we have seen from a product mix across the board historically, you know, we've been anywhere between, you know, 60% notebook, 55% notebook, to, you know, 35 and 40% desktop. Well, starting from the end of February, March and April timeframe, that has shifted the mix of really, you know, pivoting towards a mobile compute environment. So up towards what we're seeing of close to 80% notebook and 20% fixed desktop or small, even small form factor desktop purchases. But, you know, what we feel at Intel is that, hey, great value proposition of our vPro platform. And it's crazy to feel that, hey, we are 15, 10 years into vPro and vPro solutions, and definitely feel that, hey, that is such a strong value proposition as we look to have, you know, business continuity in place, you know, healthcare continuity in place. When you look at security, when you look at manageability, really managing this remote workforce so they have all the tools and capabilities. But also layering on top of here is, hey, what is an uncompromised business experience across the board? And that's where we feel that Project Athena, which we have invested in, have really taken a look at, you know, how people are engaging, how are they utilizing their compute, and what is the evolution of that moving forward? So we'll go to the next slide. We're going to a little bit more detail in regards to this, but on the vPro side, across the board, performance and connectivity is a key thing. But when we're out engaging with CIOs of organizations, you know, their key thing is security. How do I make sure that I have the same security infrastructure and it could be applied and can be applied in a remote virtual workforce moving forward? And what are the policies? What are the guardrails that need to be put in place? How do I manage those devices that are out there? Because all organizations that really went through this mobile uptick and curve in Q2, you know, now going through a digest cycle of having all these devices out there in a very quick turn. Now, how do I make sure that, hey, they're secure and I can manage these effectively moving forward? And the last piece, which is one of the areas that, you know, I'm super excited about, and I think that we've seen the hype cycle in regards to artificial intelligence. Go to the next slide. Artificial intelligence, you know, and kind of, you know, advanced analytics and what does that mean to organizations moving forward? But I'm excited about, hey, to really ensure that we have a great device that really matches all the intelligence that we're bringing to the table and everything. And can we go to the next slide? I'm not sure. It's not forwarding on my screen. Oh, thank you. You know, Project Athena, when we look at innovation, you know, and really understanding, hey, what is the use cases that are out there? What is the, you know, how, you know, individuals want to engage and, you know, how do they need to have these, you know, edge intelligent compute devices really match what's going on and what's moving forward and really, you know, I think match, you know, really what we see going on with, you know, artificial intelligence, advanced analytics, we've got to have a parallel device with that moving forward. Some of the things that, you know, excites me in our, you know, in our organizations is battery life, connectivity, and form factor interaction as we move forward, which is key. So if you look at it from, you know, from a high level perspective, business continuity is a key. Also, as we get through this technology digest cycle and have all these mobile devices out there, how do we make sure that we have a great, you know, security, remote manageability in place? But also, but think about now is that let's look at the engagement. Let's look at the human factors engineering and the experience with that end compute device. And Project Athena is really going to be a great fit for that moving forward. So, Mike, that's all I have from a high level up. Overview perspective.
Great, great, Jared. I know that there's some questions coming in from the audience, so I can see some already. As we get ready to pull up a question, I'll throw one out to you now,
okay.
And then maybe you guys can put the polling question up while I ask Jared this first question. Questions came in is how are Intel technologies helping CompuCom deliver solutions to remote workers? I know you touched a little bit on it just now, but maybe you can summarize just a few.
Yeah, I just think it's overall, you know, solution development. You know, Mike, you know, we are aligned in targeting, hey, what are the solutions that need to be put in place, but also what are the ones that are going to be in the future as the future of work as evolves moving forward. You know, vPro is a key pillar and key component of it, a foundation element. You know, CompuCom has been a fantastic partner for us over the years and everything. And from my perspective, I think it's one of the longest within our partner ecosystem that has really embraced, you know, that security and manageability, being able to manage that virtual workforce. So I think that has just set a fantastic foundation. But then also where we're locking arms, you know, looking at, you know, hey, what does this look like in the future? And what do we need to put in place so that we can enable organizations, you know, driving that theme, business continuity moving forward? How do they manage their workforce? How do they digest technology out to those workers? How can they have that highly productive workforce that meets all the requirements that we need as we really hit this digital transformation cycle that has been fueled by COVID-19 moving forward? So, yeah.
It's interesting. I want to come back to this on the vPro thing. A number of the customers that are probably on the phone here today may have vPro already as part of their hardware solution and have just not enabled it. And now, Mark, to your point, moving that one company went from what 300 locations to 30,000. You know, how are they managing those endpoints if a disaster or some sort of security breach happens? And the ability to manage that through some of the Intel technologies, I gotta believe is high value. with very easy implementation, right, Jared?
Oh, absolutely. Completely agree. I mean, the business case, the technology use case is just, perfect for the vPro value proposition. And our thing is that when we look at the vPro roadmap, we wanted to have it to evolve even more to more user-friendly from a individual that's utilizing an endpoint, compute device where they has at the high level performance, but also from an IT organization that they feel comfortable at night. Hey, they've got the remote manageability, they got the security, just like they're on the site moving forward. So continue to do that.
So I know we've got well over 200 people on the phone today. So if you, one of our customers, you have vPro or you have questions about that, give your CompuCom rep a call and we'll see if we can pull in one of the Intel vPro specialists and get some responses to you or help you look at a business case. Anyways, let me jump to this question here that you guys have already responded to. And so the question is, Gartner research shows that most organizations percent say they will stagger the return to workplace for different employee groups. And the correct answer is D, 77%. 77% of organizations say they will stagger the return to workplace for different employee groups. So interesting. All right, let's put up the fourth and last questions we'll pull, and then we'll see if there's any other questions. People can open the lines and ask live, I believe. CompuCom connects people, technology, and the edge with a seamless experience by helping companies B or E. It looks like we're getting concierge outcome seems to be playing, enabling ready now. Some live greens. Nobody's jumping on a zero dispatch edge. And the correct answer is E, all of the above. I'll touch on a zero dispatch edge, which is C. Nobody selected that. Why would CompuCom want a zero dispatch edge when we have technicians who can go out and fix things for you? And the answer is because in connecting people, technology, and the edge with a seamless experience, the less we have somebody go out and touch something, the better the experience will be. So it is one of our ambitions to strive for a zero dispatch edge to improve the user experience. The reality is we know that probably won't happen because, animals chew through cables and other things happen, but it forces us to always be thinking about AI or analytics and other ways, self-help tools, things that can minimize the and maximize that concierge outcome, that ready now experience, and that seamless experience that we're looking for the users. And yes, we do it with a mentality that has the environment in mind. So the answer, correct answer is E, all of the above. Okay, let's see, do we have any Q&A that we want to address here?
Michael, I'll be happy to take the call about the distributed workforce, hybrid, remote, in-office staff, possible different work schedules. How do you maintain effective team collaboration?
I think that'd be great, Mark.
So it's a very good question because it's, again, one of those aspects of kind of the details of how you work some stuff out. What we've seen as best practices related to this is a couple of things. Number one is that as going forward, when people start scheduling meetings, like right now, all meetings are being scheduled, as whether they're Microsoft Team meetings or WebEx meetings or whatever other video collaboration tool you're using, that practice is going to have to continue going forward to allow people to join from whatever setting that they're in, as opposed to just saying, we're going to have a meeting in this conference room, show up here with no video connection. The other piece associated with it is that the people who are actually working on site have to be more conscious of the fact that they need to draw those people in. And so we've seen kind of three interesting practices around this. Number one was a practice that actually came out of IDEO, which they called wormholes. which is IDEO would have a conference room that had a video conferencing setup running, and it would constantly be running during office hours. It would be an open pipe that was available and open, so other people could come in and connect with another office, or they could ask somebody to come and connect with room 123 or the Galileo room, et cetera. And so it was constantly available. So when you wanted to have an ad hoc meeting, you say, wait a minute, let's get a couple people together to figure this out, rather than going through the whole rigmarole of scheduling a meeting and waiting for people to dial in. They just basically say, okay, we're gonna have the meeting in this conference room where the wormhole's open. So get, you know, connect into this wormhole, which is just a long running video conference that allowed people to walk in and walk out. They found that that technique, including putting that technique in that open kind of pipeline, you know, in the break room or in a cafeteria or in a foyer or employee lounge, helped employees be also able to kind of maintain that day-to-day water cooler, for lack of a better term, conversations. And so consider about if you will create some spaces where anybody can drop in regardless of what location they're in. And that kind of wormhole is an example of that. The other thing we've seen associated with it is organizations are starting to declare core office hours. And what they've done is they've declared maybe 3 to 4 hours a day when everybody should be online and available, and having some flexibility related to whether those core hours are in the morning or those core hours are in the afternoon, to be able to allow people who are working from home to be able to manage their schedule effectively, whether that's childcare or other activities. So if your company hasn't thought about saying, we have core hours that exist from 8 until 11, or from 2 until 4, or 2 until 6, whatever those happens to be, when we all expect everybody to be reachable via instant messaging, you know, et cetera, that's another best practice associated with keeping people in effective team collaboration. And I think the last piece that I just want to talk about as a best practice is kind of this notion of collaboration and work from home is being blended in with the adoption of agile style techniques. Because as many of you have kind of moved to agile style work in the crisis, getting a lot of things done, focusing on what only matters, being much more iterative, working with shorter cycles, et cetera. One of the gaps that people have is how do they maintain status and keep everybody aware of what status is going on. Now, a traditional collaboration tool can do that, but in many cases it's cumbersome because it's kind of made for project reporting. So think about just how do you keep everybody up to date as to what things are done? If you're familiar with agile techniques, the question is, what does a virtual wall of work look like? And how do I send alerts out when different pieces of the wall of work move from different stages or come off of that wall because they're being completed? And I think those are some of the ideas to help kind of keep that collaboration, that wormhole video part, being conscious of continuing to use video and audio collaboration tools regardless of what kind of meeting you're setting up. And then the notion of kind of figuring out, how do I keep people informed as to what status is going on, you know, similar to the way that agile teams that are co-located work with a physical wall of work type environment.
Yeah, great. Thanks, Mark. I am getting some questions come in, so there's another one I wanted to ask. And this is kind of interesting. Well, I have two, so I'm going to tee the first one up. There is a feeling that remote workers are less productive than office workers. Is there any way or reason on or proof that we can prevent that? Is that, you know, myth or truth?
So, you know, as we made the, you know, the transition to the, or, you know, Mike, and you hit upon it in the first part, I feel that, hey, we have worked probably 20-25% more time, you know, since we've been in this virtual, you know, workforce in a kind of virtual environment moving forward. And, you know, when I step back and look at it, is that, you know, and Mark, I talked about, you know, what is the prioritization for it? How do you prioritize the workload? How do you prioritize, you know, the big impactful, you know, initiatives and projects that we need to get done and really what we need to drive? So, like, I think a key thing is prioritization. One of the things that I saw anecdotally, you know, just from being in a large organization, is that people felt they went into this virtual environment and they had to set up a bunch of meetings to fill up the time, but it really wasn't necessary. That really was aligned to the big priorities of what we needed to get done. So from my perspective, it was really taking it from a leadership perspective. How do you ensure that you have the right prioritization to really enable that within your work team? You know, being very agile, not being very busy, but being very impactful as part of this. And Mark, I'd love to get your kind of point of view in regards to this.
Yeah, I think one thing that absolutely has to happen is we have to change our productivity metrics, particularly for office style, you know, knowledge related work. Because productivity, when people talk about, well, I was more productive in the office, I think you're right, Jared. A lot of that is FaceTime, and I feel more productive because people see me working. And so as we start to move more to that to that blended style of work or that hybrid style of work, our performance metrics and how we rate people has to change. And for some tasks, it'll be pretty straightforward because they'll be throughput measure tasks like customer service or sales in terms of sales calls, et cetera, you know, can be more measured by the work that's achieved, the units of work that are achieved. In other areas where it's the collaboration pieces, it's gotta start to morph, if you will, towards association with project work and tasks that get completed. And so the studies that have been done that we've seen relative productivity, especially since the beginning of the year, have shown that remote workers are significantly more productive than they've been in the past. But I think there's a little bit of a fallacy there, which is, as one person told me, first off, I'm working longer than I've ever worked before remotely, in part because of the commute time, et cetera, but also because there's something, you know, bothering me. So I'm just going to wait. I'm just going to hang in here and finish before I head home. The other piece that mentioned is we have to recognize is that the productivity we've had over the last 6 or 8 weeks has been dominated by the demand for that kind of productivity in the marketplace, customers needing solutions and needing answers quickly. So a lot of heroic work have been done, and I'm not being trite about that. I mean, a lot of people have done some incredibly amazing things. And some of that's going to kind of ebb away, if you will, as things return kind of to a more normal pace. But recognize that regardless of what you've done, the heroics, the outstanding things that you've all delivered to your customers, whether they be support or actual work, et cetera, is shaping expectations for the future. I remember back in the old digital, but pre-digital days, when digital was just coming around, you had people talking about digital and analog. And analog was associated with old and slow ways of working. And people said, well, if I'm going to be digital, why would I ever want to go back to the old slow way? And your customers are going to say, if you've been able to expedite orders, do things that have been amazing to help them stay up and running in this environment, they're setting service expectations going forward. So HR professionals, IT professionals, managers who are on this call have to start to think about, how do I organize my work to deliver those kinds of results by working smarter, by working in a more collaborative environment, by working in a more energizing environment, not simply, but just by saying, I've got more people sitting around doing more stuff so they can produce more. Because as one friend told me, said, when this thing lifts, I'm going on vacation and I'm going to use some of my vacation time. And it's like, well, okay, great. You know, why aren't you going on vacation now? Well, because if I go on vacation now, all I'm going to do is stare at a different wall. And a lot of us have been working extra hours and extra hard because the alternative is staring at a different wall. And as those things shift, we have to reorganize your work for that way. Sorry,
Mike. I think there's two really insightful points you've made there. One is that we've been more productive over the past, you know, 90, 100 days because we've had to. You know, oh my goodness, we got to figure out how to get, you know, 30,000 people remotely engaged to work. And we got to do it by Monday. And so this notion of being agile and moving quickly has driven productivity. Now, hopefully, and one of the things we're really focusing on at CompuCom is how to bottle that agility and that responsiveness and that thinking of the customer moving forward and accelerate that, which will accelerate the user experience, our recovery, all those types of things. And I think the businesses that can do that will be the ones that finish on top. And we plan on being one of those businesses. And I think the second thing that's interesting you said around productivity these last 90, 100 days is that people have been working really hard. They're staring at a wall. And the concern is that there's going to be a big lull as this starts to get into 180 days. I mean, at some point, people are going to need to take a vacation and chill. And we have to know how in this hybrid environment, we're managing that technologically and socially. So a couple of points I just wanted to stress. I have one more question before we run out of time that I want to answer that I'm getting to. It's coming in and it's saying, and I don't know who wants to answer this, Mark or Jared, but how much responsibility should an enterprise take on remote users, ISP, their ability to get good network connection at home and be productive? And the challenges that's creating for, you know, a pretty decent percentage of the employee base.
Yeah, definitely, Mike. So, Mark, I'll take kind of first swag.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Yeah, so on that piece, like, I have a long history. So Intel, like, back in the day in the 2000s, Intel gave a mobile PC to every employee or a PC to every employee. So I had to set up internet service for every single employee in the company and, you know, hundreds of countries across the board. So with that is kind of the evolution, you know, setting up, you know, I think the key thing is really understanding, hey, what are the key requirements an employee needs to be productive moving forward? And, you know, what are the infrastructure that we need to put in place? There was a question in the chat is, hey, why is Intel focused on VDI? The reason why is because we feel that a VDI infrastructure and a strong, robust VDI infrastructure really enables that virtual remote worker out there and has all the tools and everything that it needs to be and really provides that great experience. From a policy perspective, we have had to go back and forth in regards to, hey, we provided remote connectivity, hey, we weren't going to provide it, but now we're evolving now, moving forward as we get into this remote virtual environment. We want to make sure that employees and individuals, they have the right connectivity so they can get their job done. So from, let's say, from our perspective, this will continue to evolve moving forward, and we're trying to be very flexible in regards to the policies we put in place. But Mark?
Yeah, those are great points, Jared. A couple of things. Number one is absolutely do organizations who are going to have people work from home or give people the option to work from home have to make sure that they've got the tools and environment to be successful. So while many of us, for example, myself, I'm piggybacking on my home internet connection right now. While many of us do have connectivity into our home, many of us don't. And so there needs to be a policy, there needs to be an approach to establish what that baseline minimum connectivity is that the company is going to either provide kind of like in a box, or expect, meaning I'm going to give you a compensation or a dispensation or an ability to expense it, and be willing to be creative in those areas where people can face a challenge where they just aren't covered, whether that's rural areas, remote areas, et cetera. I think the other thing associated with it is for example, every company is going to have to recognize what their local legal requirements are. So for example, in the state of California, if you're going to require somebody to work remotely and be connected from their house, they get to expense that internet expense to the company. The company cannot require it without providing them with compensation. And so there are some local requirements here in that regard. But I think it is important to define kind of what the minimum set is, to engineer your technologies to work well with that minimum set. But then also then be able to have your support or group or your support partner be able to work with those exceptions that are necessary to happen. Because people, as mentioned before, this move, this return to work or return to the office or return to multi-location environment is going to be dynamic. It is going to change. It's not going to be quite as, you know, you're a remote worker and you're an office worker and never the twain shall meet. And so I think that requires a lot of flexibility and understanding in those policies that really start with kind of defining some minimum standards, standards that work well with your collaboration tools, that work well with, you know, the other cloud provided tools you're working with, that then also support the levels of required security.
Yes, I think that's the bigger challenge than just how is it paid for or expensed. It's okay, I have the connection in the house. now my Wi-Fi is not working, or the applications are taking up too much bandwidth, or I got three teenagers who are gaming and nothing's left for me. Those are some of the things I think that we've got to arm wrestle with going forward. And those are some of the questions that are coming through on the chat here. So look, with that, it's about 2 minutes to four. So as the moderator, I'm gonna start to wrap up here. First and foremost, I wanna thank Jared and Mark for participating and sharing some of their experiences and insights with the group. So we'll give a virtual round of applause for you guys. Thank you. Last but not least, thank all of our customers and prospective customers for spending an hour to hear what CompuCom, Intel, and Gartner have to share about the future of work. This is the first in a series of panels, seminars that we'll be holding. The next one is tentatively set for, I think, July 22nd. We'll make sure that you're on the invite list and let you know who we will be having as our panelists and guests in that session. But at the end of the day, whatever your challenges are in this new hybrid remote return to the office environment, if there's any way CompuCom can help you, we would love the opportunity to serve you each and every day. So thank you for attending our first series, and we'll look forward to continuing the dialogue going forward. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.